Lord God, we bless your name for another day like this. For we are here to learn and to make impact and to cause a change in the society, Lord. We bless your name for that. We pray the Holy Spirit come and teach us, come and fill us, help us to do what we're going to learn today. We commit those on their way here into your hands. We pray that, Lord, will you bring them here safely to your glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
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 No cries.
Oh,
no cries. Amen. So without us wasting much time, we want to invite the medical heralds for musical time. So I put our hands together for the moment.
Yeah.
in the sand. And I've seen that I'm going somewhere. The moment I see I want to follow her, so I'm going to make it like sheep. But so there was kind of like she was this animal. By the time I get to the room and come back, she didn't be there. So was I eternity? And again to one who are kids, someone who does shimmer. You go and give it to them. Mama, keep this for me, right? I am with your mother. When I come and told Mama, I am with your mother. The next time you go to Mommy to give you the mentality, I don't have one and I turn around when they are sick. This self-experience is really hard. I sit back and I ask, is this integrity? Is that what God would ask us to do to our children? What are we doing to the society? So before Auntie comes to each of us, our guest speakers, we want to call on our Auntie ZMC, Jackson Obro, to give us ministry update. Let's put our hands together.
Low price, going price. Once again, you're all welcome to the second edition of Gaffer's Kumasi Associate Fellowship meeting. Shortly, I'm going to give a brief update on what the Lord has done for the zone within the second quarter. In our last associate meeting, we had an update on the what the Lord did for us in the first quarter. So for the second quarter, I'm going to give a highlight on some of the programs we organized, highlight on leadership training, evangelism and discipleship, resource mobilization, leadership transition, and all the other programs that were organized in the zone. So I want to begin with evangelism and discipleship. By God's grace, within the second quarter, a total of about 4,887 students were exposed to the gospel of Christ on our various campuses. A total of 612 students are currently going to discipleship. GAFES has come up with cell group system, and with GAFES we call it the Contact Family Group, CFG. Currently in the Mid-Ghana zone, we have about 105 active contact family groups in the zone. And a total membership of 555 students are part of this family, this contact family group, and are going to active discipleship. We have come up with a mentorship system that we want to encourage all associates to sign up so that you can be given the opportunity to mentor some of the students who want to be mentored. So far, since we began this program, we have 15 associates who have signed up. So, fellow associates, if you're here and you do not sign up, if only your shadows will permit you, I will encourage you to sign up to GAFES mentorship system so that you can help us mentor some of the students who are willing to be mentored. And in all, we have 38 students who are mentees to these 15 associates who are mentors in our mentorship program. Now, in the second quarter, we organized the GAFES Finalist Integrity Conference for all the final year students within the zone. The first of which came off on the 19th of June 2021. It was held at CMF CAP, MB1 classroom. And by God's grace, we have about 107 finalists attending this conference. And the theme for the conference was the need for people of integrity. Our main speaker was Mrs. Theresia Jackson. And then we had a panel discussion with the topic winning the off-campus battle with Mrs. Theresia Jackson and the Reverend Mrs. Mbaka, one of our panel today. We also had a topic on entrepreneurship, career and branding with Mrs. Ama Ajay. It was a very wonderful program and a lot of testimonies came up. Because of time, let me briefly take one or two testimonies that were shared after the Kumasi Sub-Zone Finalist Integrity Conference 2021. Now from Augustine Balfour, who are a BSc Agriculture Science student, that is from Amsterdam, Mampong, formerly UW Mampong, have this to share after the conference. He said, "I have much insight into how to establish and manage my own business. Already, I'm into production of liquid soap, oiling cream, shower gel, turpentine and others. But I lack the necessary skills to improve upon my brand and grow my business. But now, through this conference, I have been enlightened and equipped to climb to higher heights. Now, Benjamin again, a student of CMF Carlos, will have this to share. One thing that speaks significant to me today is the subject of integrity. I learned that being a person of integrity will make you all in this world. Thus, the path of integrity is not all rosy and smooth, but it is worth pursuing. There are so many testimonies that came, but that's what permits me to share all. Now, having talked about the finalist integrity, within the second quarter, we organized various training for our new executives. That first, we call our training for the new executive local leadership training seminar. And in the second quarter, a total of 32 students were trained. 12 from Gaffer's Garden City University College, and then the rest came from Christian Service University College. A lot of testimony also came after the training. These students were trained on topics like understanding Christian leadership, introduction to Gaffer's IFES EFSA, how to build a vibrant Christian fellowship, and the devotional life of a Christian leader. Now, again, moving on to the next associate fellowship meeting. Within the second quarter, the zone was able to organize our first associate fellowship meeting in Trinani. And by God's grace, a total of 20 associates conveyed at the Eastbeth Hotel, Trinani, for an impactful fellowship meeting. The topic for that associate meeting was "The Change Begins With Me, the Gaffer's Associate and the Man. The Gaffer's Associate in the Marketplace." And our speaker was Engineer Retired Ebenezer Amonu. He spoke on the topic during the Sinyani Subzone Associate Fellowship meeting. And then leadership transition. By God's grace, since some finalists are leaving campus, others are coming to take over from the mantle of spiritual leadership. So far in our fellowship in the zone, 6 local fellowships have handed over. The rest are still on their vetting processes and they are getting ready to prepare themselves for their handing over. But by God's grace, we'll be able to train all these new executives who have taken over the new mantle of spiritual leadership in their various local fellowships. Now let's go to resource mobilization. In the second quarter, in the month of May, the zone was able to raise an amount of 17,596.11 Ghana cedis. And that means that we're able to exceed our target. Our monthly target is 15,000 Ghana cedis. So by God's grace, the Lord help us, and we're able to. Can we give the Lord a clap for that? Now, in the month of May, we had a bit of reduction. The zone was able to raise an amount of 9,471.24 Ghana cedis. And then by God's grace, in the month of June, we were able to achieve our target. And in the month of May, in the month of June, sorry, we were able to raise an amount of 15,000.87 Ghana cedis. And what really helped us to reach our target in the month of June was our new initiative, 5 for 5 by 5. It is a new resource mobilization initiative that has been introduced by the zone to help every associate to be able to give even the little amount that you want to give to support the Ministry of Gaffer's. We had the first edition in the first quarter, and by God's grace, the second one came forth in the month of June. At the end of the second 5 for 5 by 5, the zone was able to raise an amount of 6,659.37 Ghana cedis. And so by God's grace, this is how far the Lord has brought the Ministry of Gaffer's in the Mid-Ghana zone. So we want to encourage you to continue to support us with your prayers, with your substance, and with whatever resources are available we can use to support the ministry. So that together we can change the university campuses for Christ. Because we believe and we are motivated by the fact that if we're able to change the university campus, we change the world. God bless you for your audience.
Once again, we are all welcome to today's associate with me. It's really a joy always to gather to share fellowship as key partners of the great ministry gathers. By one way or the other, I believe we are all benefited, and we want to see the great cause continue. That is why we are here. We left our homes to be here with us today. Thank you very much for making time to be here. So I want to quickly welcome and introduce our panelists for today. We have three special people who are going to lead us in today's discussion. And I want to, on the first on the list, welcome a lecturer at the University of Science and Technology. And he's specifically he's in the food science department. And as far as I know him, he's a former provost of the university. And he's in the name of Professor Igor Odum. So we are
by virtue of where they find themselves
and the excuses they want to make for themselves. They define integrity to suit their own comfort or area of operation. Right. But today, we want to look at all aspects of it. Biblically, we want to also look at how it applies even on the other side, in terms of people's mindsets and how we apply it, specifically in the home. Right. There was a statement of a quote I saw that said that a nation thrives on integrity of the home. I don't know whether you agree to it or not, but I'm sure by the time we are done with today's discussions, you may either agree or disagree in the speaking. Right. So once again, you are welcome. And we welcome our online audience too. We are really grateful for you making time to join us. And we also pray that you enjoy every bit of this program. If you have questions, you can also send them in. Is there a way the online audience can participate by means of questions? Okay, so feel free to send me your questions. When we have the time, we'll read them out and get answers to them. Thank you. So, I wanted to go straight to the topic we have at our hands to deal with. Integrity. In fact, it's really interesting to know that in a lot of corporate institutions, statements, they have our values, they have integrity first. Wherever you go, it's integrity. Then you need excellence. Integrity, excellence, and other. But as to whether we, the integrity that play, is another thing, right? And we'll get to also find out some of the things and how it plays out. So the topic for today is, or the theme is, integrity at home, changing the nation through the family. Integrity at home, changing the nation through the family. I want to find out from Dr. and Mrs. Why do you think the family is a strategic institution in national transformation? We'll come to the issues of the program. But why do you think the family is a strategic institution or a strategic in national transformation?
Thank you very much, and thank you, Dr. Executives, for this opportunity. I'm grateful for my husband, who is also an associate here. Why is integrity needed, integrity from the house needed for national transformation? I did a little research, and the first thing I will say is humans form the central point upon which everything is made. As we are on Earth, we form the central point around which any transformation, anything that is being done, technology or whatever, we form the point around which anything is done. And the family is the conduit through which we transfer culture. And the culture we know is in terms of discipline, hardworking, honesty, truthfulness. That is the conduit that we train the members of the family to get these attributes or characters. It's the transfer. The family ensures that there's a transfer of these attitudes from the older generation to the younger generation. And this one, it's not academic wise, it's the life that we live. That includes so much, because you can tell me what to do, but if I see you doing it, I have more impact than you just using your mouth to say. The other thing I would say concerning this is the family provides the platform upon which majority of attitudes are derived or are inculcated. Most of us here, you have evolved based on experience, you've learned many things. But your basis in life, you recall when you stay with your grandmother or your grand-auntie or your mother. So, if nothing at all, I think we being the central point, the family transferring all these characters on us,
give us the reason why the Pope is the conduit for imputing integrity for national development.
All right, thank you very much. Because when we talk of conception, it's different, but anything that is not wholesome, the person is not complete, is distorted, things are not clear, it is not absolute. Anything that looks, oh, maybe it should be deep, but when it is distorted, then it's not whole. Integrity, because integrity is different from distortion that you see around. That is what I will say. Unwholesomeness. Unwholesomeness is not integrity.
All right. Thank you very much. Please let's give it up. Thank you very much. Okay, so unwholesomeness. Anything that is unwholesome, anything that is destructive, anything that is opposite of Job's situation is not integrity. Right? All right. So let's come down to understand what really integrity is. In fact, I'll be grateful if you could even give a biblical definition and what now is more like the accepted definition. If someone may want to put it in a better way, like the worldly concept of integrity. Yes, I'm grateful that you help us understand what is integrity.
Okay, so as I said, not
having
integrity is everything that we Job chapter 2, verse 3. For lack of time, then the Lord asked Satan, "Have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and stays away from evil. And he has maintained his integrity even though you urge me to harm him without cause." The little complication I did, when you make a statement, anything that comes after is an explanation of whatever you said before. So I'm dividing why God says Job is a man of integrity. The first one is he feared God. So I would say that to have integrity is to fear God. As Christians, that's the bottom line. And he follows the instructions of God. He stays away from evil even when challenged. These are the three things. The fear of God, following the instructions of God, and the third one is even when challenged, even when there is no one there and you know that this one, I can go away with it, you still maintain that attitude. And Jeremiah makes mention of she interprets or explains integrity as doing what is right when no one is watching. So, and we know that God has said that he has written, now the word is written on our hearts. So we know what, as so far as we are listening to the word is there. So when no one is watching, I still maintain that no matter how difficult it is, when we are writing exams, I would rather fail this exam than do an illegal thing of asking someone about the answers. That is integrity. And it's something to be treasured. In according to Job chapter 27, verse 5, it says that I will never concede that you are right. I will defend my integrity until I die. Build hedges around our house with all the CCTV and everything, because we know in our house we have things that we've worked for many years. So if Job is saying that I will protect my integrity till I die, what is it in it for him that he's willing to die for? So that means integrity is far worth more than any property that we can fight for now. Now that we are having sleepless nights, passing through traffic to get the money that we need to buy that car that we treasure or the house that we treasure.
but the integrity that we are talking about today is far more worthy than our treasures. And the Psalm 25 verse 21, it says that may integrity and honesty protect me, for I put my hope in you. So integrity is also our security, our protection. When something happens and they say that, oh, this one, I'm sure that Teresa did it. Based on your integrity, someone can stick their hand in the fire, but I am not sure she is the one who did it. And that is security for you that no other lawyer can stand in for you. The last thing I'll talk about is Psalm 119 verse 1. Joyful are people of integrity who follow the instructions of the Lord. So apart from it being a treasure, apart from it protecting you, it also brings you joy. It brings you peace. And there are no money. It's when you lose your peace in Christ that you know that, hey, and no medication can give you that peace that integrity will give you. So that is the godly side. In the second one, they said, as Prophet Joseph, wholeness, having a strong moral principle.
So can I interrupt a bit here? Thank you for helping us with the godly side. Let me let Paul handle the other part. And then if there's any point you want to add or something, I'll come back to you. So Paul, over to you. Please, sorry, before you go on. Audience, please help me welcome in our midst, Reverend Vincent Afar. Reverend, you are very welcome. Thank God for bringing you here safely to join us. At the moment, we have started, but we haven't gotten far, so we are still not too late to join in yet. When, after Prof, I'll come back to you. Right. Okay. So Prof, over to you. Thank you.
Well, the word integrity is derived from integer, which is a Latin word that means whole. Cold or complete. In the African, South African, there's a word called Ubuntu. And Ubuntu stands for coldness. It means even an African knows that the person that when they say the person is wholesome, it means the person has values, the person practices what he believes. You won't question that person life because when you see the person is a complete person because he's practicing what he believes in. So that is the word Ubuntu, completeness. It refers to a human state of virtue and wholeness. So when we talk about integrity, you can have a collection of virtues that if you put it in an open, you see it being displayed. One of it is honesty. The other one is courage. The other one is honor, respect, responsibility, restraint, ability to control yourself. We talk about authenticity because it's a standard. You measure everything against it. So, it means that a person's way of life is consistent. Not today, the person is this way. So there's a consistency in integrity. There is conviction in what? Integrity. There is intentionality in integrity because you are doing it, you know exactly what you believe in, the moral principles on which you hold on. Those standards are very important. So that is why we say it is wholesome, complete. So when they open you up, your yes will be yes, your no will be no. Anywhere you go is the same. So you have some people, they might not even know scriptures, but they have been able to build consistency in what they do. They have a certain thing. There's a story I heard about a businessman
who was going to hand over the company and give everybody a seed to sow. The people didn't know that the seed he gave to them was a non-viable seed. So he distributed the seed to everybody. I don't think that was a Christian company. I don't know. But he gave them this seed. So they all went. He gave them the time to come back. So when they all went, they started planting. They were watering and looking at it. But you see, some people saw that because they wanted the CEO position, they must do things they shouldn't do. So some were looking and changing the seed and putting new ones in because they knew the type of seed. But there was one who took it home, and that is a family, I would say. The husband and the wife started watering every morning. They were reading together. So after some time, it was not sprouting. It was not showing anything. The man was worried. The wife says, "Don't worry. You have done your best. You have done your best. Don't worry." Then the day came for them to go back. That is the day they will announce who will take over from the old man. Everybody carried their seat. They were excited, talking. This man left home. Thank God for a good wife. He encouraged him, because some of us in the family, we confuse our children, we confuse them when they are standing on something, they don't have people. Because this time you need people to stand by you, really. So the wife says, "Don't worry, we are going like that." So they carried the pot and went. The story is that all the others were showing their seats has grown, looking beautiful, greenish. This man went to sit at the back, sat at the back. Then the CEO said, the next CEO is, I've forgotten the name, mentioned the person. Everybody looked around. Then the man said, "The seed I gave to you could not germinate. It's not a viable seed." So what happened then tells you what integrity can do. Nobody was watching. I don't know if the person was a Christian, but he stood and had a support from the wife to maintain that the seed did not grow. It didn't grow. So I can manipulate. The others manipulated and they lost the position. That's what wholesomeness is about.
We've heard that integrity is the fear of God, doing what is right when no one is watching, completeness, wholeness. Integrity, like Paul added, is manifested in virtues such as honesty and truthfulness and all others. And also she mentioned that in integrity you have consistency, right? We would want to... Okay, so for all those who just joined us, you are welcome to our first associate meeting. We are discussing issues of integrity in the family and its impact on, let me say, national transformation and issue building. And we have here with us Reverend Vincent Apar, and then we have Dr. Mrs. Reverend Vincent Apar from my far right. Then Dr. Mrs. Ifua Obusuansa, and then we have Prof. Ibok Oglo. We will continue. So, Reverend, like I said, you've not missed much. So we want to hear from you. We wouldn't want to leave here not tapping from the knowledge that you also have to share on these issues. The first thing that we wanted to find out was why the family is strategic in national transformation. Before we even came to tackle or to look at the first issue of what really integrity is about, let me hear your thoughts on that in just a minute, and then share your view on what integrity is.
All right, thank you so much. I'm sorry for coming late. Every society is made up of families. is the family that determines what the society or the community is. The family is important in making a nation. There's a way I put it, if you go to a place like, and don't be offended if I use your education as an example. If you go to a place like the Zongo area, the Abuapu area, and you go to Amadio or KNFC area, both places are inhabited by human beings. But you are living in the one place is well defined, other is not. If you move the people who are staying in the Amadio area to KNFC, move the KNFC people to Amadio area and give yourself some 10 years, you can imagine what is going to happen. Anyway, I think in a better way of putting it is if we move all Ghanaians to Singapore and move all the Singaporeans to Ghana and give ourselves 10 years. When we go back, the Singaporeans, when they go back to their country, will wonder what happened here. And when we come back to Ghana, we will wonder what has happened. It's a human being, the individual, the host, the families that make up the society. Actually, when God created man, God's system of continuity, training, bringing up a generation, is using families. So in the trauma, you commanded that you teach your children will teach your children. So it is human beings, by the way, civilization, moving away, instituted things like schools. A system of transferring knowledge and whatever is through families. So every society is built by families. So the moment an individual or the families are not right, then it has effects on the nation. So I believe that in Ghana here, if we can really have individual homes, individual families to build themselves up, we'll have a better nation. Because even though people are indisciplined, there are people in Ghana here who are disciplined. And you can trace it to where they are coming from. So it's important. So we cannot close our eyes to what the society or the family, the role that the society plays. So for a nation that does society. When you talk about integrity, what comes into my mind, I will go with what Prophet Book just talked about, wholeness. Integrity means that it is complete. It means that what I say is what I do. And it has nothing to do with who is looking at me. It has nothing to do with who is going to pat my back. It is your personality, which has nothing to do with the audience. It is who you really are. It is what God sees you to be. It is what your heart says you are. Not what you want to impress people. So integrity is being whole. And it is the currency with which you. It even though it seems that people who are dishonest seem to be succeeding. In the long run, the people who are honest will be the people who will succeed. Because when everything is done and the books are closed, the people with integrity are the people who make it, not the people who are just impressing people because of what they get from them. Yeah.
Right. Thank you very much. Please let's give it up for him. So, in fact, I will not end my questions. I'll take one or two questions from the audience, but before I come back to that, I want to find out this issue of integrity. Concept that we've put out a definition, whichever form you want to look at it. We want to see how this practically plays out in the family. Having established the critical role that the family plays in our nation building. So I want to find out how do we integrate or how is integrity lived in the context of the family. How do we live it out practically? let me start from this problem.
How do you live it out? Well, I'll use food. Because it's one of the things we in the family eating together. If we serve food on the table, okay, like in my house, I don't control how much we take. Because I was trying to see if people would learn how to manage. It is now appreciated why my mom used to. Because people come from different places to see, so you can enter into the kitchen and take. If it says a home that practices integrity that has been mainstream, you see that if the person is given the opportunity to dish the food on his own, nobody needs to say, think about a question. Think about effort. Are you getting me? When he's going, that is at the mind of the person, so he will take just enough, but is remembering the quantity in the pot. For all of us to eat it, then I have to take this quantity. That is when you see that there is something about integrity. So when you now see it when they have buffet, and you see how people, it tells you something happened at home, and always say so. Because food and money are two key things that you see integrity is becoming shaky. Yes, we can practice it, but when it comes to food, so I'm using food. So in the old system, you can see mommy put plates and dish, and they all sit together and eat, and one thing they do is to take the meat and the fish. If you are from that type of family, they put aside. But now we've done it in such a way that you're sitting and everybody has his plate. And you're getting this into the plate, so you know what will happen. The person is eyeing the best. But that is when you observe the children at home and begin to say, remember, we are five. So that is the nurturing that can take place. So I'm using that as so we mainstream it by saying, think Akosua is not taken. Daddy and mommy have not taken. This has not. So you use that setting to mainstream what? Integrity into the home. Thanks.
You go for programs and there's a buffet, and within a short time, there's a shortage of food. You are the number there, just a few people. Right? You don't know what happened, but a lot has happened, or a lot may have happened by then. And I think it all boils down to some of the practical things that happen, like from the home.
Right? I see the home as the first missionary field. I can't go out and evangelize when my son or my husband cannot testify that my wife is a true woman of God. And there's something to be intentional about. With what Prof said, she thought that she had an end game. How I want these children to see food to be. So with time, what I have learned is to practicalize the word of God. Not to make it abstract, or if you read it, don't steal or don't tell lies. One example, just this afternoon, we were eating and my son wanted to use spoon to cut his chicken. And the dad said, use your hand. He says, no, I want to do it like how mommy does it. So all that I've been doing for him, he's been looking at it. And one thing I always see in practicalizing, if I say God is a healer and he can trust him, when he's sick, the first thing we do is to pray. And even if we have to take the medicine, I tell him that this medicine, it doesn't have any power till God uses it. So as he is growing up, he sees that God is the first healer. And when he needs something, I tell him, speak to God about it. You see that God will do it. And he sees God doing it. So it's not you coming to tell me that when I give it to you, I'll get it back. No, he has already seen it in the home. Not being a signboard that it do what I say and not what I do. We say one thing and our actions are different. Every time, and I have this thing, any time I go to the market and I come back, I pray over whatever I have bought from outside. So even when I forget, the lady who helps in the house, money, we've not prayed. And that is the day-to-day, trusting in God, putting the fear of God. It must start with the Bible, but they are reading and I am learning to also be conscious to do the right thing because I have set the pace. So I have to be conscious to practicalize whatever I've said. One example I will give, and I think I will give to Rev. I told my son not to use his tablet when it is charging. And he stopped because it was a command. Then he saw me using my phone when it was charging. He says, "But mommy, you said I should use my tablet when it's charging. Why are you using yours?" And I said, "I am wrong. I am sorry." And I put it down. So with this, I've confirmed and I'll be conscious not to do it again. For myself, maybe you see it with the dad, but I have given the command and I see that he sees that I have made a change. I've apologized. The day-to-day, this is how we will imbibe integrity in ourselves. As we have developed it as adults, we will be conscious to follow it. And the young ones, they will see that. If we say God is a protector, they see it happening. If we say God is a, they see it happening. So it's not when they go out. Even when peer pressure, whatever, we know that whatever they have received, they will hold on to it and they won't go back in the wrong way. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, so, Rev, before I come to that, mentioned something in the presentation. I just reminded to say that we have to train our children to think of one another. Because if you are concerned about an equal share of what you are having for the same for your neighbor or for your brother, then some of these things can play out in everything that you do. Right? And Mrs. Owusu Ansan just said that she sees her who has a mission for her. So she tries to, as much as possible, make the word of God more practical. So if the word of God says she didn't lie, she tries to make it more practical for them to understand what it means not to lie. Right. There's this story I wanted to share, and that relates a bit more to thinking. So it's more like loving, but as yourself, you get it. Some of these things play out daily in our life. There was this CEO who had, the owner of a company had a CEO working for him. And then at some point, this person actually is a contractor, for him, and he builds for him. And I think usually when he gives him money to build, he cuts corners sometimes with the construction and all. And he worked very hard. And at some point, the man gave him a huge sum of money to build. He said he should build, like, with that money. He gave a description of what he should build, but he didn't tell him. Like, he just gave him the money to build. And he went to build. And just like he does often, this time he actually bought inferior materials and all that to build. Right. And after building, the one who gave him the contract and the huge sum of money to build, just came to him. He had handed over the keys. But the man handed over the keys back to him and said that this is your house, like for painting, for serving. Me, this is your house. So just imagine what has just happened. He built with inferior materials, thinking that he's doing it for somebody to come and live in it, not knowing that he's building his own house to live in. So that is how sometimes these issues of integrity play out daily in our lives. Red, let's hear it on this.
Thank you so much.
One of the reasons why children tend to believe their teachers more than their parents is because whatever the teacher teaches them, they put into practice and it works. If a teacher says 2 plus 2 is 4, wherever they go, they see 2 plus 2 is 4. If the teacher teaches them the CAT means cut, wherever they go, in the home, it's difficult. One of the reasons why a lot of pastors have children not serving God is because what they hear their fathers preach and what they see they do are two different things. It is known that 65% of things that people see sticks with them better. Only 35% of things that they hear. The other problem we have in the home is that we always come in too late. Within the first 10 years, you should establish a certain foundation. After that, everything is already established. The children come into this world with, let's say, a virgin mind. The reason why 2 guns can do better and the child cannot speak a single gun is because even though they were born by guns, it is what they give the child that the child takes in. In the home, what the children see is what makes them. And what they see, they begin to see as early as in fact. Research has shown that they begin to see as early as when they start developing in the womb. Research has shown that. There was a research that I read somewhere in Canada. They took pregnant women and they played different types of music. And they used a scanner to check how the babies in the womb react. And the result of this research was that anytime they played classical music, all the children in the mother's womb, irrespective of the mother's father, they move like being lullaby. And anytime they play the rock and roll and those kinds of, all the children began to move like the way the fetish priests when they are. And personally, I've come to realize that whenever children are being developed in an environment where there's absolute affection between father and mother, the children develop better. Research has shown in the home that they don't have money, but they have good relationship amongst them. The children develop better than the home that they have money, but the relationship among the people is not bad. What am I trying to say? What the children see is what makes them, and as they grow, it sets up their foundation. So in my home, for instance, we have tried as much as possible that we will never want to come in too late. We start from day one. Even as tiny as one day, we are mindful of the words to use. In our minds, we know that they can hear. A lot of people in their minds, they think that they cannot hear. In fact, there was a family that came to me for counseling. And because their son, 19-year-old son, was misbehaving, like a very bad boy, stole in the school, was displayed in front of the whole assembly, and a very innocent, noble young man. When they came, and I asked the man that I want to be alone with the boy. So then I started asking the boy some questions. And the boy said that, I've always tried to teach my father a lesson. And that's why I said that my father has always wanted to kill my mother. And I said, how do you mean? He said that I remember one day I saw you killing my mother. So we ended up. Then I called the father. He said, I never had a like that. Then I called the mother. Then the mother said, yes, I remember. Once we were in the bedroom and we were arguing about something. And my husband took a pillow and put it over my head. I was trying to kill him. Then I asked the mother, when was that? He said, when the boy was 4 or 5 years. And I asked, where was the boy? He said, the boy was in the bedroom.
So 4 years, now 19 years, 15 years, that image has been controlling his behavior. So if you really want to achieve integrity at home, because the children at home, we are really naked, you need to be conscious of whatever you do and say, whatever. If you talk to them about song that glorifies God is what is good, you're in a car, listen to FM, and it's playing some wedding music, and you start tapping your and nodding your head. Yeah, complicated. When you are driving and the traffic light says red, and because you're in a hurry, you quickly drive through it, the family is learning that rules does not mean rules do not really matter, especially when you're in a hurry. So if we really want to establish integrity at home, we need to be mindful of everything that we do. I like what you say. If we are said, I don't sit here to eat. The father of the head of the home doesn't mean I have to sit there to eat. In my home, you don't have to sit in the TV area to eat. So sometimes I remember when they were young growing up, just a cup of tea on a saucer. And I just wanted to get closer to the television. Because they were discussing, we were talking on the dining table. When I moved, the TV area, you have to descend some steps. I just wanted to. Then the youngest of the three children said, Daddy, you know, eating in the TV. A typical, normal, African, Ghanaian man, your response would be, you give an excuse, you give a reason why you should be exempted. And sometimes I said, who are you talking to? It's your father. So I just said, I'm sorry. I came back, put the tea on the table, went to listen to what I wanted to listen and come back to it. It's difficult. If you really want to teach integrity at home, it's difficult. Especially in a place like Ghana, that everything around us, when you are doing things right, you become abnormal. The last illustration I'll give is that when you are in a car driving with your family and you are eating, let's say, oranges or granuts, the one we call pomme, and you crack it, the thing that is a tiny shell, you drop that. You have to kill a little something. So you need to put it in a car. So that when they want to do that, they know that it is not done. It is difficult, but it is possible. But when God was able to tell the devil that, you see my servant Job, I can bet you that he's a man of integrity. In the same God is the God yourself, so it is possible. Thank you.
Thank you for that insightful contribution. So, Reverend said something, and sharing about the boy in council and getting to know what happened. You know, I just want to bring our minds to how such a situation at home relates to the impact it has on society or the nation. You realize, as a result of what the boy had grown into, because of what happened in the home, he now, it is society that now began suffering the consequences of what he had grown into now. So he's now stealing from people. I'm not sure it was just stealing from home. He was causing trouble outside, not just his home. You get it? That is the kind of relationship we are talking about here. That everything that happens in the home, don't think that it just stays within the four corners of your home. The result of it is felt more even in society. Right, so I want us to think through some of these things carefully and begin to make some resolutions from today, how you want to handle your home. You get it? It's like at a point, I was hearing more of children. But you realize that it's like this about the consequences of the perfection among parents. You get it. And in the end, like I said, they translate it into what they become, and the society also suffers the result of their actions at the end of the day. I have a question, but before I go to that, I want to give an opportunity to one or two people to ask questions. Maybe as a result of this opportunity, they even have the last question that I have to ask. So I'll give the opportunity to you, my beautiful audience sitting here, to ask your questions. If you have any questions from our online audience, please, you can kindly read them out for us. But we appreciate you also for sticking with us, our online audience. Thank you so much for being part of today's associate meeting. Please, any question from us? Any question? Yes. Please, can someone help us with the mic? Okay, just
you are my solidarity. Please, my question is to Reverend. Okay, the boy has seen this. Can there be any correction so that it will wipe that sort of sin that he saw, that can correct things? Or put it more perspective, with the parents, did they change or they just continue how they were doing? That's why the boy came to that stage.
All right. Thank you so much. Can I go ahead? Yeah. I don't think the father continued trying to kill the mother, but that image was created. But just yesterday, a 12-year-old girl that was brought to me, the parents wanted to divorce, but they were separated. And any time you're talking to a 12-year-old girl, I make mention of a statement, the girl begins to weep. When I start talking about other things, she'll be smiling. At a point where talking to the moment I move to some point and mention that the girl begins to weep, it means that there's something called trauma. That incident has created that. Unfortunately for us as Christians, because Christ can take care of everything, when we give Christ the opportunity, it is possible. But sometimes we also need to help the individual. In fact, in Ghana here, one of the strategies that I've used, skill that we use, is when the father will apologize in the presence of the child that what I did was wrong. I am sorry. But there was a case like that, so everybody was crying, the father was crying, everybody was crying. So then it began. But sometimes you need to take the person through a process. Yeah. So it is possible for me to be there. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Please, any other questions to my audience here?
Okay. What is bothering my mind is the growing number of persons who profess to be Christians that still we have integrity challenges. So if that could be addressed, I know that I've left it too open, that what would make people confessing Christ or professing to be Christians still not leave in integrity?
Thank you. Okay, please, you can go ahead, please.
It's been my prayer topic for a while now. And to affect the entire world, we will start with a spark of light from where we are now. So in my little corner, maybe, and when we mention family, we've been mentioning the home, but when I get to work, I know they're working in family. So, is it that I will change when someone brings someone's issue to gossip and I change the environment. So the person cannot come back to gossip about anyone again. Is it that I start the little things that I do that affect the outside world in my working in with my patients that I see with everyone? Can I start with that? With the prayers, we really need it. Now I see we have churchgoers, we have those who profess to be prayed, but they are not convicted. They've not really met Christ to the point that I am nothing, I'm willing to lose everything for the sake of Christ. But rather it's like, I do you, you do me. Because you are doing me, I also do you. And it transcends in medical fields, in the hospitals. People are willing to sell supplements that they know that this one will not give you jack. But it's so expensive too. And at the end of the day, Wakujaba, they will count their monies, and when you see their cars, you will think that they have arrived. So I think that wherever we will pray concerning the entire community, and we start with Ghana, 70% or 60-something% Christianity, it's I know God, if God is to punish us like the way he punished the Israelites, we will be gone a long time. Because the corruption and things that are happening, it's and when you read the Bible from Exodus, Genesis, what the Israelites did, that God sent hailstones on them, we are doing worse than that. But we are saying we are Christians, and it's worse in the marketplace. Now, you can't trust a lot of food poisoning because of the chemicals that farmers are putting on their vegetables. And they will say that they have their own small farm that they cultivate food for their family. And they have the commercial one that they spray on and make the fruits ripen fast so that they will sell and get their money. But in these marketplaces, we have the evangelists and these pastors standing there and preaching. I think I'm adding to your complaining. But what we can do, start with ourselves. Let's be willing to lose everything for the sake of Christ. If people will say bad things because I'm standing for Christ, I know that at the end of the day, how long will I stay on here? 70, 80, 90, 100 years. My million years of years eternity is worthwhile. Thank you.
Thank you so much. He didn't add to his complaint. He actually gave her one, two solutions if I had it right. The first thing that she said was to pray about it and also to start in your own small way. Right. Thank you. What would you want to add after what's happened to you?
Well, I always ask myself, to be frank, I'm a very practical person. I don't like theory. So if I read the Bible, I want to see how it works. Are you getting me? The Christianity we do now is so theory, I can't see it discerned. You see, it must move from your head to your heart, and then you begin to act. All we do is knowledge, knowledge. So personally, when I read the scripture, I believe in the doing. I believe in what? In the doing. What has happened to us is that we have turned everything on God's. God will do it. God will do it. And I won't do anything. Are you getting it? If God puts me in a place, why am I there? So why do I pray the prayer, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Are you getting it? So do I even know what is happening in heaven? So that when I get to my marketplace, I'm implementing it. No! All what we know, the prayer, if you see the content of our prayers, is what I can get here on earth. You don't ask. The last time you asked God, what happens in heaven, Papa, so that I can do what? Implement it in my workplace. These are deep issues. Until Christianity moves from our head into our heart and begin to act, it will see what you are seeing will be the same. I believe in practice. This Bible is real. It's what?
Real.
There's no passage that doesn't mean. Let me share a story with you. I was in an office, very hungry as the head of department. Then we used to do references for people. So I was working and I got hungry. Then I asked the secretary, please, can you order for food for me? So she went and ordered for food for me. So I ate the food. I didn't know how she ordered it. But then it occurred to me that maybe she has used one of the reference money to pick the food, to buy the food. So when I got home, I was just ordinarily reading the story of the old prophet and the young and the old prophet. I'm telling you, the young, if you want this Bible to be real, God will make it real. I was reading the story of the old prophet and the young prophet, who God gave an instruction to go to where the old prophet was to do something. And he told him, after that, do what? Come back. Don't eat, don't do anything. When I finished reading, the Holy Spirit said, that is you. Tomorrow, go back, ask the lady, if whatsoever it was, give the money back. And I did. The lady asked me so many questions. I said, that is her. So when you see my secretary and she's talking about me, to tell you that lady is somebody who practices what you believe. We don't practice what we know. When was the last time when you read the Bible and he spoke to you and you acted? So when I finish presentation, the passage that comes to me daily and I speak it out daily is John chapter 13 verse 17. He says, now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do. Blessing doesn't come when I go and pray at church and I don't do. It doesn't come when I'm just moving around like this and then somebody lays hand on me. I must be intentional and practice what God says. That's why he says that this book of the law should not be packed from your mouth. You shall meditate on it what? Day and night. He didn't say, some of us don't have devotion. It is not that. How can a young man maintain purity? What does he say? It is by keeping the word. My dear brothers and sisters, until the church take this, that it is practical, we'll be doing theory and moving around, nothing will happen. You must be very intentional, consistent in this. So it says, let it not depart from you, day, night. And it says, observe to do. It didn't say, just pray. It says, do what? Observe to do. What does observation mean? In growing up the child, nurturing demands a lot of observation in the home. We are all busy. When do you observe? When the child is doing something that you know, it takes time to observe. We are all chasing money. And when you say, we are busy. Please, let morning devotion come back. Let it do what? When it comes back in the morning, you all will be exposed to the same scripture, the same reading. Are you getting it? So if mommy is saying this, and he says, this is what mama said, but mommy is not doing it, all of us will be corrected. Will be what? Corrected and rebuked in the devotion. Are you getting it? That is what we should do. In the evening, call the family. What did you learn in the morning? Did you use it during the day? People will say, what happened? But this must be consistent. I am Grace, it's here, she lives with me. So what I'm saying, she knows. She knows that we practice. Grace, am I lying? Grace.
Let me hear that for Grace.
She stays with me. She came as a student, MPhil student, and decided, because I've also decided that others can come and stay with me, not just my word. My own biological children. When was the last time you have opened your mouth for others to come in to spend the time? We are so close up. We must change. We must do what? Change. I have a lot to say, but I'll stop here. But practice now that you know these things. You'll be blessed if you do. Please. A little verse. Our mothers did not know how to read the Bible. But when they go to church and the pastor said they were, they put it in their pocket. That is what they used to move around. You, is it Twitter? They are preaching. Social media? They are preaching. Marriages, stay together. Aqua has spent all his life counseling marriages. Still! You people want to practice what we tell them. refused to accept the Bible, it means we have not encountered Jesus Christ. Anybody who encounters Jesus Christ is a changed person. May the Lord deliver the church. Give us that encounter that the Holy Spirit will work on our hearts to respond to his calling. Amen.
Passionate response. Reverend Akwa, in just a minute, add it up and then tell us. I think this basically has revealed some of the crises we have in our families, contemporary families. Just give us highlights, a bit of highlights on what a contemporary family is facing with related issues of integrity. What we are battling with now when it comes to integrity in our families.
Or the contemporary era, our definitions have changed. So one of the words that the definition has changed is prosperity and success. So now people respect people who have the money, not people who have character. People who no matter, I mean, imagine in Ghana here, I mean, people know that people are stealing Sakawa to build houses, buy cars, and the teachers and the workers who are honestly working are not getting those buildings. But they are not respected. The people who have the mansions, they are respected. And even it happens in churches, where sometimes the people that seem to be rich are the people that are offered and welcomed nicely, as compared to those who are not put up mansions. That's a contemporary era. So because of that, now everybody's chasing to be there. So selfishness has become the order of the day. Years ago, that we were thinking about our neighbors and our society, now it is more of myself. So the moment the society has become like that, now the family members also become selfish. To the point that a father or a mother can decide to go and buy examination questions so that my ward will pass and go to the school that will appear that he's successful. To the point that now in Ghana here, I know, because my son was in that exam stream, they were writing an examination. An invigilator could come into the room, a room that's about sitting about 100 people, an invigilator could come into the room with a sheet of paper and announce to that 100 people that there is someone who is writing this part that we need to help to pass. So I'm going to read out, it was objectives, I'm going to read out the answers in the room, not knowing who is there, who is not there. What am I trying to say? The society has accepted these horrible, terrible, evil things as normal. If you don't do it, you are branded in a certain way. Anybody here who is a teacher would agree with me that when you are in school and you are an individual of integrity, you are branded. But once a student asked me, said, do you think we go to heaven? And I asked him why. He said that because people have written an assignment and I've gathered all those who had copied. There were 150 students, but you see, integrity. It requires that I read through every script and be sure that this copied from that, and I gathered all of them. So if 20 people copied, what it means that the 20 people share the same mark. Then he was asking, because they were saying that you should not be hard on us. Allow us. That is the world in which we are. That's a contemporary era. And unfortunately, families have started believing. Because if I don't get the exam questions for my work, it's not going to pass and go to a school that is the top of the town. So I've been forgotten about the fact that exam malpractices is evil. The most important thing is my son or my child has gotten the A's and it's a testimony. And sometimes even in church, people are giving testimonies talking about how they begged, I don't know whether that's the right past tense of bet, lotto, and they have gotten money, and people praise the Lord for that. That's what I'm aware of. But you see, our God has not changed. I think we need to redefine when the Bible says that you'll be prosperous, you succeed, what it actually means. The world only looks at all these things one-sided. But we, that we say that we know God. You really don't need to be very rich to let people know that you are successful. Like my pastor said to me, a place to keep my head, food to eat, clothes to wear, and content. He's seen as a happy individual. So I think in the contemporary world, it is more difficult. But that is why we need to get closer to God. Because the more it is difficult, the more we need a firmer ground to stand on, a firmer hand to hold up.
We want to appreciate you so much for your contributions, for the insights that you are sharing, for the passion with which you are sharing these insights with us. We want to take your concluding statements. Our time has run out. We will just take your concluding statements. Like I said earlier, we cannot exhaust this issue or this topic of integrity. But at least some basic foundations have been established. At least we have come to understand the impact that our family has on society. And the fact that if we need to get it right, it needs to start from the home or from the family. Right. Some of the suggestions that come for us to practicalize the word. They do as the word says, not just acquire the knowledge and be the theoretical Christian, but practicalize it. Right? We should live it out. That is one of the things. Setting the right foundations, even for in our homes, especially for our children, right, to work in these tenets of integrity, right. So, like I said, we are going to take your concluding statements, and as you do that, you can just chip in how maybe if there's any other encouragement in terms of how we can better do this, we can better achieve. Or win the fight of integrity in our home, which will in the end have a resultant effect on our community or society. We can check all these things in. And we'll do this in. If you beg me, I want to give each of the mic more and 2 minutes. Is that okay? One. Please let me be generous. 2 minutes. Thank you. Maximum. So I'll time you. Give that 2 minutes back. Respectfully. Is there a question? It is well. Please, I'm sorry. Please. Okay. I'll be nice to give you an opportunity, so please ask your question.
So please, as you now have a child, who gets the result?
Hold on, please.
Now that's what's happening. So I have a child, she gets 10 months. I want her to go to Gabe. I have to pay 8,000 Ghana cedis before she can go to Gabe. Is that bribery? Is that integrity? Because I don't want my daughter to go to a school that maybe I don't want. Maybe if I don't pay the 8,000, they will take her to a private school. I want her to go to the school that I want her. Is that?
You want me to be very truthful? You want me to be very truthful? It's bribery. I can talk about how God has moved where people have not paid and God has still moved. We can talk about that. Not to bore you, I can talk about, let me just allow me because it's going to. I have a son who's a lawyer at the moment.
Sorry, let me check this in. Right after I just concluded your remarks, then
we'll all right, thank you so much. And I have a son who's a lawyer at the moment. And you know, law school, before you go to Makola, before you go to the bar, it's not that simple. And I remember one time somebody called me and said that, you know big people, and I know, so we can't do this. Then I said that. But one of the reasons why personally I don't do anything like this is because I don't want my children to learn it. I have never driven and met a police officer and given the police officer money. Because most of the time when I'm driving my children in the car, I don't want them to have a mind that I can use Vice City to go through it. I've always talked to them that I can use talking to them and praying in my heart to go through it. So this time that I'm talking about, now, miraculously, for the first attempt he failed, then we paid. Then the second attempt he failed. What I mean, you're paid to write the examination again, very expensive. And when he was preparing to write the second one, he was there and a friend called me and said, I've seen your name in the class list. That the final thing to be called to the bar. He said, no, I failed. He said, no. So now we had to go and see the list. Interestingly, we found a way of getting to know the list. And his name was there, not knowing he had passed or whatever. And he got the information that he had failed, so he was prepared to write the exams. So, to cut a long story short, either he really failed, but God did, or he had passed, and the information was given wrongly. Now you can imagine how now this boy sees God. And it has caused him to be drawn closer to God. Beloved, integrity pays. Sometimes, as human beings, we want quick results. Fast results. And that has been a problem. When the Bible says that, let me just read the scripture. I'll read just some two scriptures. One of them is Proverbs chapter 11, verse 3, and Proverbs 27. Proverbs 27 says that the godly walk with integrity, blessed are their children who follow them. Honesty guides good people. Dishonesty destroys treacherous people. Then Proverbs 2 says to me, okay, he guards the path of the just and protects those who are faithful to him. So then when we read some of these things, they seem to be far away. But I don't see how God will write something and he will not use it. Our problem has always been, I have to see now. But there is something I always tell people, that sometimes when God is delaying things, he's making it better. So that by the time it comes, it will not destroy us. We know people who got some brand new cars and they killed themselves within the first week. In fact, there was a couple, and the woman came to me and said, if I knew having money would have destroyed my marriage, I wouldn't have prayed to God to give my husband money. The man is now rich, and they don't have a goal. Integrity pays. All that we need to do, we should trust this God that we believe in. His time is right. He will never come into it. Thank you.
God bless you.
I'll conclude by saying that we should remember that we are in a bad
and the armor that God says we should wear, we are never to put it down, because the devil is relentless. He knows his time is up, the end time. We are so close with all that the Bible said. So what do I have to lose? If my child is not everyone who went to Wesley Girls has prospered. Someone went to a village school and the person is now on top. Who decides that? Is this the same God that we are being truthful to? So it is a battlefield. Never remove any of your armor. And at the end of the day, it will pay off, because we are serving, I say, a show God. He wants to show forth his word that it is true, and he will make his word true in our lives. Amen.
So much for staying with us all, to this.